We are sitting here with the first Grandmaster of Goa, Anurag Mhamal. Anurag, welcome, and you are 4 out of 4 in your hometown. How are you feeling playing the first GM tournament in Goa?
Hey Sagar, it's nice that you could set this sort of interview up with me. But regarding the tournament, I'm quite happy that I have scored 4x4, and it's been a good tournament so far for me. Today's game was kind of a mixed bag, and it wasn't really. There were some miscalculations which we are going to discuss and show you that humans do make mistakes and like make bad judgments sometimes. Maybe you can learn something through this.
So being in Goa and being the only Grandmaster of Goa doesn't make you immune to making mistakes.
No, it's just a part of the learning process. I'm still working towards it, and I hope I do get better. But I mean, playing something like I did today, I mean, I haven't done that quite often. So,
you were playing Aniruddha Deshpande?
Yeah, I was playing Aniruddha Deshpande, yes.
And what's his rating?
I suppose he's somewhere in the 50 above. I'm not sure. I did not check. Okay.
And you said that you tried out something new today. What is it exactly?
Actually, the thing is that I have been trying out some new openings for myself, which because I haven't been into the mainstream kind of openings. So it's new for me. I'm pretty sure it won't be anything new for all you people. But it was kind of a new position for me because I was not aware of the... I have seen it earlier, but I was not aware whether I continued accurately after knight h5, bf4, knight h5. I was aware of the main lines with knight e4 and the other moves with a6, knight e6, etc.
If I'm not wrong, it's something like...
Yeah, the knight e4.
And then there is a sack sometimes.
Yes. Knight d2, rook f4, gf4, and then black has a few options.
Yes.
And he could also go rook b4 instead of capturing the... instead of taking the bishop, so that is, it dwells into another line.
Correct. But knight h5, and I remember that you as a player, you like playing things like the Veresov, d4, d5, knight c3, and maybe Trompowski, and sort of offbeat systems.
Yeah, that is exactly what I said. Like, I've been playing kind of the sidelines, some of English, Ricky, etc. So it's not been into the mainstream openings where... I have been into like studying all the main openings because like a lot of effort and work goes into it, but I was not actually aware of how to do it properly, and memory is also not that great. So
why this change all of a sudden?
Because like at the top level, the if you observe any games at the top level, you don't see much of the sidelines, etc., except maybe in the blitz format or the rapid format. So if you want to really play for an advantage, especially with the white pieces, etc., you do need to move into the mainstream openings, because like playing the sidelines, they are okay once in a while, but if you want to really fight for an advantage, I think the main openings are the way to go.
But it requires a lot of hard work, and you are willing to put that in now.
I'm trying. I'm working towards it. But it was not just about the work, actually. It was like the method to actually do it, like actually study it. Like sometimes it's just not just by hitting everything. You have to understand the position. So getting a feel of the position is also quite important. It's just not by hitting the lines that works. So unless you like play the position often, maybe at a friendly game with a playing partner or something, it's not entirely advisable to just go and play those openings, because there are so many options out there, and positions can change into a variety of structures. So that's one thing you have to keep in mind when you start playing this kind of main openings. But I do follow games and like play a little bit, so maybe I'm just starting into it. Let's hope it goes well for me.
Anyone who's helping you in particular to make this shift, some coach or some second or friend?
No, not really. I've always been working on my own, and I've been doing that since a long time. I did work with Akash Thakur when I was a kid, and after that it's just like a mentor kind of. He's been my kind of a mentor, but I haven't really worked with any particular coach, and I'm not doing it right now also. I kind of work on my own. I don't know if that's entirely advisable, but that's what has been so far. Maybe down the road I will try to get to a good coach so that maybe he can guide me properly in the right direction. Yeah.
I would like to talk about Akash Thakur and a few things a bit later. We'll first go through the game, and I think we should move to the critical moment. Was it somewhere around?
I think it was. This is a position I think White is clearly better here. Now this is an idea that H3. I played H3 because knight e5 seemed very obvious, and he seemed to be playing fast until here. But after H3, he did take some time, and maybe this was a new move to him too. And I've not exactly checked it, so I'm not aware of exactly what White should continue to be the best move. But H3 seemed like a good move to me, because the idea is that after knight e5, you go knight e5. Now, supposedly, if he takes rook e5, can I play that?
Yes.
Yeah, after rook e5, I was planning to play g4, knight f6, and further develop with. Queen f4, I suppose. Yeah, I mean, I'm not entirely sure, but bishop e5 seemed more natural, so I was calculating that more. But the thing what I saw is after g4, knight g7, it seemed like black has some problems with his pieces. He can't exactly improve, and that seemed like a factor which helped me decide to play h3, g4. But the engine definitely may not agree, but I felt like this was okay in my perspective. And after knight f6, what I saw is that after e3, he does have problems because f4 is an immediate threat. And I believe his only move was knight d7 because he needs to keep the bishop. He can't just give it on c3. So after knight d7, now I played rook b1 with the idea of playing b4 immediately. See, the problem with black is if he needs to improve, he needs to move the bishop to g7 maybe back, or play a6, b5, queen c7, b5. So he does have a lot of time to improve his position, which gives me kind of a lot of moves to improve soon. So he started with a6, and I'm not entirely sure whether what is the best option. His idea was probably like, if I play b4, he'll go c4, and suppose knight e4, now he can go queen c7.
But I can't take the pawn on b4, yes?
No, if you take the pawn on b4, I think I do have a lot of play, and that was my opinion. Now again, I'm not sure, but it felt like this was not looking good for black, because although he does get an extra pawn, I'm going to roll f4, f5 soon, and again, I'm going to target the b4 pawn too. And I again got the C file also, so I don't know. I don't think this looks entirely wise for black. I think it would be. I felt it on the board like it would be better if you would play C4 here, and so I did get his idea. But I think maybe he could have started with Queen C7. The point being that after Knight E4, he again went back to Queen C7. So. A6 was not entirely necessary, which would have helped him gain a move. So, because now if I play B4, he can play the C4 idea still. And I feel like that is that was better maybe. But let's look at the game. Let's he played A6, I went knight E4, queen C7, and I started with F4. Bg7 and f5. I think this looks entirely natural, just like I blitz this.
This is a little risky also, because you're giving up the e5 square.
Yeah, I did think about it, whether it would create some problems. Maybe he gives up his exchange for my bishop or my knight, and maybe I don't have any entry point later. But considering a few things, like I am able to open the position immediately with fg6. And even if it does give the exchange, There are various ways to attack those pawns with the pawns already open. Now, if it was a fixed structure with f6, g5 or something, could have helped him. But the thing is that if he tries for that, supposedly with bf4, knight e5, I do have this fg6. He needs to take fg6 and be5. And this was just a rough simulation. I did not exactly go to calculate it all, but it supposedly feels decent enough, and I can just attack the g6 pawn with queen c2, and it was good enough to judge this position to be better for me. So now further going, I had to calculate the other lines, which were important, but surprisingly, it seemed very difficult for black to actually improve. Now, he did come up with a plan of b5, and I think it is the best way, because although if he tries to just kind of defend the king side, I feel like he would be too passive, and what he did was rightly so, because it does generate some chances of counterplay. And now, so far so good, I went with fg6. Now, the point is that I thought it wouldn't make that big a difference, and couple of moves may I felt like maybe not playing fg6 would allow him the opportunity to play fg6 somewhere, and maybe the position would change sort of like through what I wanted to actually achieve. So I started with fg6 before, but maybe rook d1 was wiser. I was still
So rook d1 before.
Yeah, I think
was
rook
better.
D1. I was not sure. I kind of calculated for a long time, but I was not sure whether it would make a huge difference taking fg6 first and keeping the option of f6 also open with rook d1. But the thing was, I was just afraid that maybe he might have an fg6 option, and I thought I can cut short my calculation and save some time. I thought fg6 might just go into the variation which I wanted to go to, and.
So he fg6 can't take
and,
fg6.
Yeah, he can't take fg6 because it just does not work here with queen h4 and too many weaknesses. My knight also can be transferred.
This is beautiful attacking position.
Yeah, I think this is just crushing. But after fg6, even here I felt like this was going to be crushing. But
yeah,
the thing is that...
Yeah, it looks completely crushing with your queen coming to h4 and your rook on f1, knight on e4, bishop. I mean, usually three pieces are enough. Here you have four into the attack, so...
That is true. Actually, I was trying to make even queen h4 work here with various ideas, but somehow I couldn't make them work. I'd like to show you the lines with bd5, and I was thinking of b8-6. The thing is, after bishop e4, you have bishop g7, king g7, rook f7, king f7, queen h7, king e6, and bishop into e4. And... I believe I thought on the board it was, maybe I missed something there, maybe he does have some defense which I have overlooked, but the thing is that the point is to calculate and look at the variations because they are just beautiful in this position.
Sure.
So, but eventually it's a game and you need to play the best move, which I felt was rook d1 to just keep the pawn, keep the bishop inside and just continue. Now the thing is, in the game he went with rook into e4, but rook e5 maybe have been better because supposedly, if I do go with queen h4 here, there is rook into d5, b into d5. Again, another interesting variation. B into d5. Supposedly, there's an interesting move, bishop d8, where you can go queen into d8, knight g5. And the thing is, you have to realize that the bishop can always come into this diagonal, bishop into a2, and suddenly there is nothing happening.
It's
in black.
It's not so easy to see that
it
you
is
can
not
give up your bishop, rook over there and...
Exactly.
Okay.
I mean, from that point, it is not easy to consider that the bishop can go to the complete opposite diagonal and just defend everything so well. So, he went with rook e4, which seems very natural considering that he can fix the knight on e5. So, rook e4, b4, although white is better now since the exchange and... White always has the opportunity to break with h4, h5, which should have been played in the game, but some excitement again, like, and a
maybe
bad decision. I was just
back,
afraid that, yeah,
is possible, or
I was, no, I was, the thing is that I was afraid that he was going to fix the knight on e5, and then after queen g3, I mean, he does have some compensation, and the game will still go on, and rook f7 seemed very pleasing to just finish it off very fast, but that was not the case. And
so I
should have calculated slightly better with, because I did have some time, and but it was not properly utilized, and rook f7 was a mistake because It was a total blunder because after rook e4, if rook e4 was played on the board, my calculations of showed me that after queen h4 I would be winning, but somehow after king g8, I could not find anything for white really to
so
make it
work. So if you try for rook f1, you have no threats really in that position.
Exactly.
Or queen h6 here.
Queen
perhaps?
h6 and then I guess there was...
knight f8 and queen h7 perhaps.
I guess it was knight f8 and then rook f1 and I think you can go back, is it?
And if bishop f6,
you can
go
queen h7. Yeah, I guess this should be fine for him. Although that does show me some compensation, but I don't think it was the wise choice because I was just an exchange up and...
you gambled.
A gamble.
And then he took on f7, so it made the game interesting.
Yeah, it did. He did take on f7, which did make it interesting. Again, after knight f6, again I was... in my analysis earlier when I took on f7, I had calculated bg6 and... somehow, I just played this quickly, bg6, because I felt like after knight f6, that was the move. Again, that's not a good thing. Again, when you have time, you could have recalculated again and seen what is exactly happening, what you missed. But I did not do that, which is not a good thing. I was expecting more of bf6, where I was going to plan for rook f1, and I thought like this should work out well. Again, I was looking at various options, but I was still considering it. But when he played knight f6, I just thought bg6 is completely... better for me, but what I missed is just king g8 is
because if
a very quiet
f6,
move, and that is
if he takes bishop into f6, bishop into
after
f6,
bishop into f6, this is an interesting variation where I can play bg7, rook f1, king g8, queen into this. Now there's another move, queen h4, but king d7, rook f7, king c8. Rook c7, king c7, that does not really work out
this
well
is similar
so
to
I
the
think,
game.
But this is quite similar to the game, but the king is quite safe here, and I think black should convert this quite easily with the pawns d5 and e3 being weak. I don't think white does not really have an... some chance, but I think black does have enough counterplay to just... to convert this game. I think black should be better in that position. Mm-hmm. So let's see this rook f7. Here, the interesting thing is queen a5, which my opponent noted down for me. But the thing is that after queen f6, this again, I was not sure whether this will entirely work out. But queen into d6, queen d7, and queen into e8, queen e1, queen d2. And I think white should be able to convert this. The only thing is, when I was calculating actually over the board, I completely forgot that I can take queen into d6 with a check and capture an extra pawn, which does make some difference to the position because it does have some...
Yeah, now you are completely winning.
So, okay, I felt like this was good to continue with. And but the problem is I just completely overlooked king g8 in my early analysis, but I already had committed to bg6, so that was not a good thing. I should have waited and reconsidered my options. But
it made the game interesting. So all of your miscalculations actually led to a very nice, interesting game.
Yeah, that is not...
Which you might not have liked, but...
Yeah, I did not like that. I mean, nobody would like to miscalculate and lead to an interesting game. They would like to play better chess than that. So yeah, I was not entirely happy with that. But after this position arrived, like I was disappointed because I started with a better position and suddenly I'm the one who is actually
fighting for
I'm just fighting for compensation basically, because somehow if the queens get exchanged, there's no way I can defend this position. So I'm just fighting for compensation. I believe that he could have like somehow saved the king. Now this was he had less time, but I believe it was better to maybe try to remove the king from the pin and work something, but considering the less time, this seemed very natural, rook f8. The idea is that I can't move the bishop, so his idea was entirely to take three pieces for the queen. Uh-huh. And
this is very similar to what we saw, but the king is on g8.
Yeah, the king on
g8
makes a huge difference because now like white has a lot of counterplay to generate, and that started with queen h5. Again, now considering that he had less time, I was quite happy that I got to play this position, because the queen can always make some...
But if I put my rook on f8...
Yes.
I don't see how you are going to checkmate me, because, I mean, even if you go g5, g6, it's still not going to checkmate me.
But, like, that is the point, actually. The thing is that my idea was entirely to keep pushing the pawn g5, h4 by creating creating small threats, and that is what exactly happened in the game. It's not so entirely easy. Now, probably the black did not play the best moves, but that was entirely due to the time issue. But it was interesting because there were so many threats generated by some moves, because, see, again, after rook e3 here, there was the idea of playing queen h7 and queen h4 again.
And you have queen d8 check. Once the queen gets in, I think you would be...
Yeah, and I have queen f4 check, queen d8 check. Again, it's not easy at all. Like, if he goes here...
If I go rook e8, perhaps?
If you go rook e8...
Ah, you have queen f4.
I have queen f4. Again, I have generated some counterplay. I can capture the d6 pawn. So, for the... That... I'm taking a piece here, so that is not going to work. So... If you play rook e7, though, I can capture the pawn, and that should work out well for me. Because it just generates some counterplay, which is good for me. And the thing is that it is difficult for black to make choices here, because white is only trying to generate what he can and push his pawns, whereas black needs to be aware of everything and try to defend. Although I feel like if he could, it would have been better if he started pushing the pawns with c4 so that he also gets a passed pawn. But the thing is that it does not immediately come to a mind in such position, because you're always worried that the queen is creating some kind of strong
threat. Want to get everything together, so you played bishop c8, trying to
get rid of
the bishop there.
Exactly.
But
it did not really help, because after queen g5, what happens is that he can't play king f8 here, because again he's losing the pawn. So it's quite naturally inclined, he's naturally inclined to play rook e8. And that's what he did. And again after h4, there was a cheeky idea here. If he plays b into b2, which he exactly did, my idea was to play queen f4. Now, the thing is that the queen f7 threat is very strong. If he plays rook e7, again, I have queen into d6. And again, if he goes back, I have queen c7. So, after queen f4, I believe it was just over for him, because there was no proper way to defend it. Now, queen h6, rook f5 leads
bishop
to...
Bishop g7 doesn't work because queen h7 is a mate.
Queen h7 is a mate. So that was the difference. By playing queen f4, I provoked him to play rook f8 and took the square away. And this helps me, because after rook f5, I can play here and I can also play this. And the bishop is trapped. So that was good enough for me to stop my calculation there. And after rook f3, I did see that I have king g2, and that is what I exactly played in the game. Now, he had a heavy time trouble here, and I was also running kind of low, but it is quite natural to play bg4, because rook f5, you know what happens after queen h7, queen c7. So bg4 led to another interesting thing, where he played be5, queen into g4, rook g3, bg3, king g3. Now I'd say I was quite lucky. If I had his pawn on c4, I would be lost. So that is the point, actually. If he had pushed his pawn somewhere down to c4, somewhere before, that would have helped him. But in this position, it does not, because after b4, king f3. Now again, b4 is quite a good move, because it creates another opportunity for him. There is this chance where he can play e4. Now suppose you play c4, e5, c3, e6, c2, d7. You would think that this is winning, because queen d7 checks. Suppose he takes queen g6, he have queen c6, and it's an easy win. But and if you move it away, again, that the queen and king is winning. You can go queen e6 and probably mate him straight away. So, but the catch here is, after e5, he can always go b3 here and change the queening square. So suppose I take ab3, cb3, ed6, b2, d7, b1 queen, d8 queen, king g7. I could not figure out if I can actually win this again. And then considering that you can actually mate on f7, I started thinking whether I can make e6 work. But after king f8, I believe I'm lost probably. Because there is no way.
The king is doing a
good job stopping both pawns. Maybe my king, if it was slightly further, it would have been nice. But the point is that b4 is a good try in that position, because you could always make. So he played a5, king a2, king g7, h5, c4, king d2. Now, I'm pretty sure like you can also go with e4 here, but there is always the feeling where you don't want to miss any opportunity, yeah, sure. So it is better to why to hurry, that's the thing. Again, after a3, king c2, because like I realized that after ab3, a2, king b2, cb3, he has no way to really stop the queening. He has no counterplay basically. So I was quite
actually,
sure that
this position is very nice because after b3 takes a2, and you'll see it's kind of symmetrical. Your pawn stop his king. His pawn stop your king, and there are two pawns, but you are just one tempo.
One tempo ahead. That is true.
Yeah, that's beautiful. So in the game, after king f6, e5, d6, e4, this is what happened, yes?
Yeah, that is what happened.
And he resigned the game.
And he resigned, yeah.
Oh, fantastic game. And great analysis, actually. We want to ask you, you were analyzing variations, many variations. You were talking about line after line. How did you develop this art of analysis?
Actually, the art of analysis, by reading books, actually, you know, understand how actually the authors, my favorite author is actually Dorotsky, and I do follow his books religiously. And in recent times, I've also used a lot of books by Agard, Jacob Agard. And another author I like is Michael Marin. I like his book, Legends.
Learn from the Legends. Have you read that book?
Anyway? Yeah, it is quite good. And it's a different way to look at the endgame, which Marin shows in his perspective, how different players play it. So it's quite a good read, and I really liked it. So that was the first book I read by Marin, and it was quite helpful for me. I learned quite a lot.
So you do it from the books.
The point of the analysis is I kind of refer to books. That's kind of old school, but I kind of like reading books. So it is you can do it yourself if on the laptop with the help of the engine maybe. But the point is that it's more important that you know exactly why you're playing it and what were your thoughts during the move or during that position. It's just not being right that I feel is important. I feel it's important how your thinking process, that is more important to look at. Now, only if you learn that, you could improve. I'm sure you can improve through calculation, but the learning process, that could be a crucial point which can help what you're exactly doing wrong and correct it. What sort of moves you look for in a position, in a certain position, during certain structures. What are the kind of moves you look forward to? Whether they are just developing moves or just improving pieces, different kinds, and that is what some things I learned from them. So
wonderful. And you told us about Akash Thakur being helping you. I guess what I know and maybe I have heard from somewhere is that he used to work with you for hours and hours, days together, and you used to work on end games and stuff. How was it like?
It was the entire point of it was just to look at chess all day. So
all day.
That is the thing, because I was young and I was not exposed to many of the end games, etc. So when it was just about just exposing myself to chess for a long time. So I think that does help generate, especially at that level, because I was still in the younger ages and I was not aware of nearly any opening at that point, so or any end game at that point. So developing yourself, that comes only through looking at chess. So that is what we were doing.
And you were something like 1800 and then you really shot up to 2200.
Definitely.
Or something.
If you do work on chess, you're definitely going to shoot up, whether it's 1800, 9, whatever the rating, that is not important. So if you do look at chess continuously and for a long period of time, you are going to improve. So I believe that is very crucial to everybody.
And what about this tournament? You're going to play 5 rounds now. You already played 4. You're going to the Isle of Man day after tomorrow, I think. How do you feel the tournament happening in your state?
Actually, yeah, that is actually one of the best things, actually, because there has never been a Grandmaster tournament in Goa ever. So having such a tournament, it will catch the local attention, and I think that is more important to chess in Goa. Now, chess in Goa is quite in the developing stages, but tournament like this, even the promising talents and the players, they get to they get an opportunity to actually see the players who are actually in the top elite now. The players in the top 10 here, some of them have really played in the top elite, so amongst the top elite. So that the experience, how their psychology, etc., for them is kind of a new thing, and they get to learn quite a lot. I think that will in turn lead to more chess in Goa. I think overall, the chess culture in Goa is not as great at the moment, but I think a tournament like this, maybe somewhere down the road, even more. So then I think the chess culture in Goa is really developing, and I'm quite happy about that. So then we see some more promising talents in Goa come
up. How did you imagine that you could become the GM when there were actually not even any IMs in Goa, yes?
Yes. Actually, my entire goal has just been to play better chess. So that is what I was doing. I did not... I wanted to become a GM, but after a point, it was just about like trying to play better chess, and that is what was important to me. So I was not looking at the targets entirely and setting goals, but I was just trying to play good chess, trying to improve myself so that I play good, and that's more important, that I play well on the board. So.
Well, I have played with Anurag, and I have been sort of a competitor with him for many years. And today,
definitely,
seeing you analyze these positions, I can surely say that you have still a very long way ahead to go. 2600, 2700, everything is waiting for you. So, Anurag, all the best.
I will try my best. Thank you. Thank you, Sagar, for having that faith in me.
Yes, and great analysis, and I wish you good luck for Isle of Man.
Thank you. Thank you, Sagar. Thanks a lot.